Last year we saw Gotham debut in this hall, and it was astounding. Now we've seen the season, which has blown people away, and now we're going to see season two. So are you guys ready to welcome some of the citizens of Gotham? You know, I don't think they heard you that time. I think we need again. So let me please have the pleasure to introduce the creatives and cast of Fox's Gotham. First of all, the executive producer, Mr. Bruno Heller. It's like the long walk. All right, we're gonna do everyone, quick. Also executive producer, Mr. Danny Cannon. You know him as Detective Jim Gordon, and you're gonna know a lot more this season, Mr. Ben McKenzie. Please welcome Ms. Morena Baccarin. And of course, Detective Gordon's partner of a sort, Mr. Donal Logue. You know, if we're going to talk about umbrellas, we might as well bring out the man himself, Mr. Robin Lord Taylor. Mr. Sean Pertwee, otherwise known as Alfred. Camren Bicondova. Hello?
Cameron.
And of course, the young Mr. Bruce. David? She's here, Erin Richards. Mr. Cory Michael Smith? Please welcome also executive producer, Mr. John Stevens, and again, Mr. Jeff Jones, also executive producer. Well, this, I guess, is the mega cast for the mega panel, so I guess we'll start off right away. Bruno, we just saw the rise of the villains. So what are we going to see in season two, guys?
Season one was very much about old school Gotham, about Gotham in its early days. The mafia, that old-school kind of crime. This season, as it says, it's the rise of the villains. There's a new breed of villain. Crime is getting more theatrical, more grotesque. The stories are becoming larger and more epic as the city starts to decline into chaos. So this season is bigger, more colorful, more intense, more exciting. More.
Well, we have some of the villains of a sort here on stage. And of course, we have one villain in particular, Selina, who seems to be struggling a little bit between if she is a villain or not.
Well, that's life as a teenager, isn't it?
It's been a long time for me, brother. I don't know.
No, a lot longer.
What has it been like for you?
Oh, it's been great. I love playing the character. I love everything about it. And I'm excited for what's going to happen this season, because she's going to be trying to figure out where she stands, whether she's a bad guy or a good guy, and I get to see a big part of her background, so I'm really excited about that.
Jeff, I wanted to ask you, I mean, you know, the Batman story is so well established. I mean, I think besides Sherlock Holmes, he's the other great detective. So in many ways, what were some of the concerns and challenges of bringing this, I guess, backstory or prequel? What do we call it, Bruno?
Well, first off, he's better than Sherlock Holmes.
Yes.
But honestly, it goes back to Bruno and what Bruno's vision for Gotham was. It started with Bruno, so really finding someone, you know, all these characters, whether it's Batman or anybody, it all starts with the writer and the showrunner. And Bruno had a very specific vision for Gotham. So I never forget when he pitched that first scene that Selina witnessed the murder of Bruce Wayne's parents. And that, to me, right away I knew, oh, he's got a vision, he's got a perspective, he's gonna add new things that you don't think people could add to this mythology anymore. There's more stories told about Batman than any other character ever. That's cool. And you need someone like Bruno to really give it a spin, and then Danny Cannon to realize it, and this amazing cast to bring their own takes on all these characters.
We have dogs barking in agreement. That sounds like Gotham City out there.
Uh-huh.
You know, one of the things, of course, that we've seen throughout this season, and we saw in the season finale, is if you call season two the rise of villains, another part of it is the rise of Jim Gordon.
Yes.
So, Ben, I wanted to know, for you, coming through this first season, you guys are now, it's a whole new ball game for you, for both of you guys, I suppose, the great police of Gotham City.
That's right. Yeah, as the villains rise, there's an arms race, and the good guys have to increase their force as well. And I think there'll be new heroes introduced on the good guys' side, and they'll have to band together and fight the rise of the villains. So it's a pretty exciting time.
What is it like for, you know, the relationship between the two of you guys was so vital to kind of establishing the tone, in many ways, outside of Young Master Bruce and the backstory we all know. How do you think that relationship between the two of them has changed now?
I think it's grown more complex. The two of them understand each other better, and Harvey has taught Jim a lot of things about how the city actually works. I think there's a mutual respect, and I imagine a partnership for years to come, right?
Yeah, I think so. It's interesting because I don't know that much more than the audience really knows about what's going down, but I have a feeling that, you know, Jim Gordon reinvigorated Harvey Bullock. It kind of woke up this thing that had been idealistic in him years ago, but at the end of season one, with the kind of rising tide of anarchy, I think Harvey Bullock's just really, like I look right now, old and tired and beaten, and it really feels like it's this senseless, quixotic task that you have this tide of just so many bad things coming, and you're just standing there with spoons in your hand and you can't fight back. So I think, you know, I think at this stage when we find Harvey in season two, he might be beaten down. He might be a little less idealistic than Jim Gordon about our chances to stem the tide of the bad that is coming.
Erin, you know, this the first season saw emphasize a lot from the very beginning the relationship between you and Jim. But now there's another woman in Jim's life. I wanted to get a sense from you guys about how that relationship is and how it's changed.
My relationship with Jim?
Bizarrely enough, I can't hear you down here.
That's louder than I thought it was going to be. So, I mean, the relationship between me and Jim has obviously changed quite a lot because I killed my parents. And he's a police officer. So it's strained, to say the least.
Do you think that the way the character, the way that she's developed, do you think that we're gonna see more of a change from her? Or I guess maybe I should ask Bruno and Danny, what are we gonna see
happen? She's not gonna get less crazy, is she? No?
No. She's the crazy ex-girlfriend from hell, but she's also, but she also becomes a woman in full, in her own right. It's a story of insanity, but it's also a story of fulfillment and fulfilling your potential. Just crazy potential.
To talk a little bit about fulfillment, let's talk about Alfred and Bruce.
Mm.
You know, we saw, obviously, the first season was really telling from the terrible tragedy onwards. Now, are we going to get more of a sense of the relationship between them? You know, it's not a father-son, it's more like a mentor and a student. Sean, David, where do you guys see this going?
I think you've got to go away with any relationship to sort of come back, and it's been a sort of tumultuous and bumpy ride. The relationship has been, because he's not his actual father. He's sort of inherited the position. I think that you're going to see in season two more of a contract being drawn between them, and you're going to see him start to train. And now you're also going to see Alfred come out of the traps a bit more, which I'm personally delighted about. I won't be making so much cups of tea and things like that. So I'll be out and about a little more. So yeah, it's going to be a more adult relationship, I think, and of mutual respect and understanding.
I think that in season one, because Alfred isn't Bruce's father, they were constantly butting heads, and Bruce was kind of saying, "You can't tell me what to do. I'm going to do what I want to do." And they were just constantly not agreeing on things. And because of the revealing of whatever's down that staircase, I think that really takes, it's a new chapter in their relationship. And they're going to go through a little bit of a rocky patch, but once they get through that, you're really going to start to see him become his mentor, and they're going to be on the same team. And like Sean likes to call it, Operation Good Guys.
Operation Good Guys.
Danny, for you, being that we all know where this eventually ends, with a certain cape and a certain mask, how do you get the story to keep going, to keep telling us a new way of looking at Gotham, a new way of looking at Batman? What are the elements that were important to you?
What I'm understanding about this as we do it is the villains have lived forever, and they've been some of the most known villains in history, I think, and it's because they don't have those blocks in our head that teach us how to be. They live outside of that. They are anarchy, they are chaos. You know, they are free in that mm-hmm. sense. And I love their freedom, I think we all do. When somebody really doesn't give a damn, they become incredibly interesting. And so this season is all about the origins of so many more villains. Not just what's happened to all these people and what they've gone through and what they've become, but what Gotham can give birth to when people start to feel power within themselves and don't feel that urge to have some petty, timid morality. They can be free, and that's exciting.
We want to take some questions from you guys very soon, so if you have them, start lining up. There's microphones set up around the hall. You guys have questions? Yeah. All right. To follow up on what Danny said, though, let's talk about one villain in particular, Robin. It seems that you have definitely risen.
Oh, man. What happened?
Well, so,
where are the giant people at? Yeah!
What do you think, where is he now from where he was when we started, when he was just like Fish's waiter, essentially?
I mean, yeah, he achieved his goal. He's the king of Gotham. We'll see, I mean, yeah.
For the time being.
This guy, well, and that's a good point. I mean, you know, like he spent the whole, first season, plotting all of this, laying the groundwork, having finally achieved it. You know, he's intelligent. He knows that once you reach the top, there's someone right there ready to take you down. So, you know, he's prepared to, fight to stay up there. You know, we'll see what happens. It's never a smooth ride with Oswald, but yeah, he's living large now. So yeah, it's good. Hey guys, yes.
Cory, could you be the person to take him down?
I don't know. I think we should ask them.
All right, well, do we have some questions from you guys? I can't see anyone. Oh, my God, they have lights. That's amazing. Hello.
Hey.
Please say who your question's for if you can. Hi.
I'm Jaden. A huge fan of the show, actually. First, this isn't really a question, it's a question after. First, I want to say I've had a crush on Cameron for the longest time.
Catgirl blush.
My question is, this is for anybody who wants to answer, who is your favorite cast member to work with and why?
Oh. Well, mine's David, without a doubt.
Mine's not Sean. I'm kidding.
I think what's interesting about this show is that every time you get to work when Sean and I got to do something special last year, obviously, because working with Ben is a dream, but it's exciting for us sometimes because we were locked in different worlds where we didn't interact, that every time we got to interact with each other, it was kind of like on any given day, we are all each other's favorite person to work with. It's a really tight group of people.
Wow. You don't hear that from a lot of cats. All right, so we have, that's a very bright t-shirt you have. You could be seen without the spotlight.
Thank you very much. I'm a huge fan of the show. I just wanted to start off by saying,
my question. Oh! Oh!
Hey, how high is your pain tolerance?
I think that they're telling us we gotta get off the stage. I think we have a new friend in town. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for the cast and creative of Gotham.